So, whilst we were singing and worshipping, I felt God say he wants to talk about the power of the Spirit. So this morning I was talking about, again, the intimacy with the Spirit and also developing the relationship with wisdom, because it's about wisdom of God this morning. So I encourage you to listen to that or watch that. And someone said, a friend of mine, John White, he said this morning, he said, the Holy Spirit, when it comes inside of you, when he comes inside of you, that's for you. But when the Holy Spirit is resting on you, that's for everybody else. I never really thought of it like that. It's like, yeah, that's true, actually. Holy Spirit within you is for you because it will change you, it will sanctify you and do all lots of other stuff to you that you might not like, but there we go, hallelujah. But the Lord is within us and changing us, making us ever more Christ-like. But when the Spirit is on us, that's when it can affect, he can affect and change other people's lives. And I'm reminded, Jesus, when he was with his disciples, just before he ascended into heaven, it says that he breathed on them. Now, what's interesting about the Greek word there for when he breathed on them is that that Greek word is only used one other place in the whole entire Bible. It's that rare a word. And it's used in Genesis where God breathed on Adam. So what happened there when Jesus breathed on them the Holy Spirit, something very significant happened. It's a bit of a mystery. Some people say maybe that's when they got born again, so to speak. No one really knows. And then he says to them, in the book of Acts, tarry ye here in Jerusalem and wait till you're endowed with power from on high. So the disciples, they had the Holy Spirit now within them when Jesus blew on them, but they still needed something else. And Jesus, okay, now let's think about this for a minute, brothers and sisters. Jesus is God in the flesh. Did he need the Holy Spirit? Yes. Absolutely he did. And this is something we don't often think about. You know, some people get a bit funny about this. Like, I know some people say, no, the baptism of the Spirit, which is like an immersion in the Spirit. I'll explain that in a minute. People say, no, the baptism of the Spirit is not a secondary experience. When you get saved, you're immediately filled with the Spirit and you're baptized in the Spirit. But that's not what the scriptures say. The scriptures say that you're sealed with the Spirit when you get born again. Now, when you read the book of Acts, you'll see several instances where Peter was out with, met with the brethren. And he starts talking to them about the Holy Spirit. And they're like, we didn't know there was a Holy Spirit. And then he laid hands on them. And then they received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Okay? So these were brethren. They were already saved, but they hadn't yet received power from on high. Okay? The apostles themselves, they had been breathed on by Jesus. They'd received the Holy Spirit. But yet, he said, tarry in Jerusalem until you're endowed with power from on high. When Jesus was baptized, before that time, he did no miracles that we're aware of. And then he went out into the wilderness. And it says, then he came back in the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus is the pattern son. If he needed to be baptized in the Holy Spirit, then guess what, brothers and sisters? You need it too. I remember once when I was younger, but I was a pain in the backside to be fair. I was at this Church of England church where I was at the time. And I said to this guy, I think he was at university. I said, look, mate, man, you need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And he was like, I think I need to go away and pray about it, see what God says. I mean, what? You might think, well, surely that's a reasonable thing to do, right? No. It's a really unreasonable thing to do because actually God, Jesus paid the price for the Holy Spirit to be outpoured upon all flesh. It's not his right to pray about whether it's God's will or not. It's basically, this is God's will, receive it. Amen? But he might not want it, Chris. I don't care. He needs it because if Jesus paid for it and shed his blood for it, then he needs the power of the Holy Spirit in his life. Amen? I'm reminded of this preacher. Jared Cooper, that's it. He said he had to train up these people to do evangelism on the streets, and this was in America. And he said he was speaking to them, and it was like nothing was working with these guys. They were clearly saved, and they were like, oh, we've done all these courses, and whenever we go out in the streets, there's never any results. There's nothing ever seems to work. Nothing ever seems to happen. And he was like, I don't really know what to do. They did go out and do. I think they did something on the streets, and it was just a disaster. It was like, God, what is wrong here? And the Holy Spirit said to him, they have not been baptized in the Spirit. Now, these guys, bless them, come from a more of a cessationist camp. That means they don't believe in the outpouring of the Spirit anymore. That kind of happened with the apostles, and then it stopped at the death of the apostles, even though there's nothing that says that in the Bible, but there we go, sola scriptura and all that. But anyway, forgive my sarcasm. So he said to them, have you ever received the baptism of the Holy Spirit? And they're like, well, no, not really, because we don't really do that. He said, how about we pray for the baptism of the Holy Spirit and see what happens? So he prayed for them. They got filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and they went out, and then suddenly, when they evangelized, people gave their lives to Jesus, and they saw things that they'd never seen before and experienced things that they'd never seen before and experienced. And it's like, it's just because of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And it's one of the things that I find that this is something that really upset me a while ago. I started going around to charismatic churches, and this really shocked me and saddened me. I was going around to these charismatic churches. They had the great bands. They had the Nord keyboard. I mean, that is like the worship standard keyboard in any good church, okay? So we've got one now. So they all have these nice keyboards. They have all the, like, the lights and the smoke machines, and they had all the gimmicks, and, you know, and everything looked great, and the great sound desk and the cameras and everything else, and they're all very lively. But there was no power of the Holy Spirit there. I was at another church, same thing. Another church, same thing. And suddenly I realized that a lot of charismatic churches are charismatic in name only, but not actually in practice. They think that having a loud worship band, having like a nice Nord keyboard, somehow is what makes you charismatic. But it isn't. It's the power of the Holy Spirit that makes you charismatic. And the word charismatic comes from the Greek word charismata, which means charis, grace, mata, gifts. Gifts of the grace of God. And he wants to place his Holy Spirit on individuals so that they may reflect something of the fullness of the Godhead, that they may go out and be a blessing to the community around them and also be empowered to help build and establish the local church. Because these gifts are for the growing of the church. And we need to see the church grow. Amen? But what we need to see is Christians empowered by the Spirit of God. And Jesus said this when his ministry finally started. And remember, this is not the Spirit in me, this is the Spirit on me. This is Jesus. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Therefore, he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the contrite of heart. Now, by the way, this is the gospel mandate. This is Jesus' mandate for the gospel. Guess what? It's also yours. Okay? Because he reiterates this in a slightly different fashion at the end of Mark 16. Go into all the world. Lay hands on the sick. Cast out the devil. Raise the dead. Okay? This is not for the superstars. This is not just for the Billy Grahams. This is for everybody. Okay? And this is... Now, listen. Because this is Jesus' mandate, it is your mandate and my mandate. He hath sent me, he has apostolized me to heal the contrite of heart or the brokenhearted. There has never been a time, I don't think, probably since the Second World War, where I've seen more broken people now than I've ever seen. Broken through abuse, broken through the filth of our society, broken through addiction, through drugs, through family breakup, through pornography, through so many different things that people are just broken. They are literally broken. And if there's ever a time where people need the power of God to heal the brokenhearted, I tell you, it's now. And we've been commissioned by God, as Jesus had been. He hath sent me to heal the contrite of heart. Guess what? I'm commissioning you now in the name of Jesus, because I'm only reiterating the scripture. He has commissioned you all, us all, to go and heal the contrite of heart. But I've already got a broken heart. Well, get someone who's commissioned to pray over you so you can have your heart. I mean, it doesn't take rocket science, does it? It's like, you know, use your brain. To preach deliverance to the captives. Again, there are so many people who are in captivity. There are a lot of Christians that are in captivity. A lot of people in captive to sin and in various forms of bondage. And Jesus wants, and this is the thing, to preach deliverance. Do you know what? When you preach on healing, or when you preach on signs and wonders, or you preach on the things of the Spirit, guess what happens? You get signs and wonders. Preach the evangelistic message, people generally get saved. You preach on certain things or the gifts of the Spirit, people start operating in those gifts of the Spirit. Because God has chosen the foolishness of preaching to preach deliverance to the captives. Now, we've got so used to these words that we tend to forget what deliverance means. I want you to think about this. You are in captivity. You are held in chains. You're in a foreign land. Okay? You're in a country that's not your own. You've been removed from your family. You're in chains. You're starving. You're hungry. You're miserable. Okay? And then suddenly in comes a deliverer with his army to free you. Now, how would you think that would make you feel? Absolutely good, right? So when you see these words here, think of them in this context. To preach deliverance to the captives. You are the light in the darkness. That when people see you, they see the blazing light of Christ. That you are their hope. You are their joy. You say, "Cool, Chris, no, Jesus is there." But you are the carriers of Jesus. You are the body of Christ. You are the manifestation of Christ on the earth. Amen. He's in heaven now. You are, like many Jesuses, full of the same Spirit of Christ that was on him. So you can go into all the world and tell people about Jesus. Preaching deliverance to the captives and sight to the blind. Hallelujah. That's a great miracle, isn't it? It is a great miracle. And see, in Jesus' day, it was deemed by the Pharisees that a messianic miracle was to be able to heal the blind. Because I think at that time, it had never really been done. So to heal the blind was like, that's a truly remarkable messianic miracle. And it still is a truly remarkable messianic miracle. So when you lay hands on someone and they get healed, especially with their eyes or their ears and stuff, it's a messianic miracle. It proves and gives testimony to the fact that Jesus is not dead. Jesus didn't die in a tomb 2,000 years ago. He's out of the tomb and he went back to heaven and he outpoured his Holy Spirit on the earth. This is good. To set at liberty. Freedom. I'm not going to do it, but I can see a Braveheart moment here. Just freedom. To them that are bruised. To them that are broken. To them that are oppressed. To them that are in the valleys. To them that are in the gullies. To them that are in the sewers. To preach. Again, there is that word. The acceptable year of the Lord. In other words, the acceptable year of the Lord is the year of the Lord's favor. The year of the Lord's favor is a jubilee year. It's actually the big jubilee year, which is every 49 years you had this big jubilee. And on the jubilee year, all debts had to be cancelled according to Jewish law. Okay, so if you owed people lots of money, it was all cancelled. If you were a slave, you were set free. If you had property and it was in your inheritance, it came back to you. The year of jubilee was very powerful. And Jesus is saying, I am your jubilee. I can get you out of bondage to sin. I can pay the debt that you cannot pay. I can give you back your inheritance, hallelujah, which the devil stole from you, which life has stolen from you, which circumstance has stolen from you. Jesus has come that you might have life and life in abundance. And Acts 10:38, Jesus went around doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. Hallelujah. All of them. All of them. Man, you only need to walk downtown. It's like, they're everywhere. The demons are everywhere. But Chris, we don't get devils in England. We only get them in Africa. This is England. We just have mental illness in this country. I'm going to get some hate mail for that. To preach the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of reward. Hallelujah. The day of reward. When Jesus returns and he gives you that eternal inheritance. You see, some people here don't know Jesus in this room. Let me tell you something about why Jesus came to the earth, okay? We all know the Christmas story. Jesus was born at Christmas time, right? Let's not go down that road into a while. Man, I don't believe in Christmas. Okay, let's just say, let's go with it for the moment. Jesus was born at Christmas time, okay? And so I know he wasn't, but we're not going to go there. Just to say this, right? You can't say anything anymore, can you, in Christendom? Because if I say something, the Hebrew roots will jump on me. If I say something, the cessationists will jump on me. If I say something, the Reformed people will jump on me. The Catholics will jump on me. The Orthodox will jump on me. So I'm just going to say it, and you're just going to have to put up with it, okay? So Jesus was born at Christmas time, and so when he was born, okay, he was born for one reason only. To be the Savior and the revelation of God the Father on the earth. To be the very God in flesh, to be Emmanuel, to be God with us. For God so loved the world that he gave us his only Son, that whoever should believe in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Jesus grew up to be the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. And when Jesus died upon the cross, when he was there on that cross, he took upon himself every single sin, pain, guilt, shame, sickness, depravity, wickedness, of all the most foul things that Jesus became in that moment of time, the most disgusting, foul thing to ever walk the earth. It says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, he who knew no sin became sin. He became it that we might become righteousness of God. And the Bible says in Romans 10, if you believe that Jesus died for your sins and rose again from the dead, you believe that in your heart and you speak it and confess it with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you shall be saved. You don't need to do some weird classes. You don't need to go through some hoops. You don't need to do 30 Hail Marys and get on your knees. It's just faith in Christ. Hallelujah. That's the ticket. And if you don't know Jesus, but you want to know Jesus, and you want Jesus in your life, and you want Jesus to change your life, and you want Jesus to bring that freedom and that redemption that he's promised here in Luke chapter 4. If you want that in your life, you just say, Jesus, I believe you died on a cross for me. Jesus, I believe that you died and went into hell for me. And I thank you, Lord, that you rose again from the dead. I believe it. And I confess that my sins to you, and I believe that you are my risen God, and I give my life to you. Take me in Jesus' name. Believe in your heart, confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you shall be saved. Saved from what? Hell. Hell. Someone gave me a cup of coffee earlier on with some caffeine in it, and I jokingly said, well, probably going to preach a hellfire sermon now. Hell. This is not something that many churches talk about anymore because it's deemed politically incorrect. But brothers and sisters, that is exactly what Jesus came to the cross for. Hell is a very real place, and people are going there, and God doesn't want people to go there. People would say, why would a just God send people to hell? Why would a just God allow such eternal pain and torment? These are questions that are difficult because we are looking through the lens of our humanity. We're not seeing things often from God's perspective. But here's interestingly, everybody who has died and been to hell and come back to tell the story, because there have been, and I know one girl in this film project that I'm involved with, and she went to hell. She said something that is consistent with every testimony of people that went to hell. They knew that they deserved to be there. There was no question about it. There was no, you got the wrong guy. There's no, I shouldn't be here. Why? Oh God, this is so unjust. They all knew that this was what was right and appropriate and just. They knew it. There was no arguing about it. But you see, this is the love of God. He came to take captivity captive. He came to break into our lives. He came to destroy the power of Satan and destroy the power of death and destroy the power of hell and Hades so that you can have life, life everlasting. Not by and by when you go to heaven, but starting right here, right now, today. If you're addicted to alcohol, if you're addicted to drugs, the power of Christ is here today to set you free from those addictions. If there's any sickness or illness, the power of Christ is here today to heal you from those those sicknesses and those things that afflict you. There is nothing that's too hard for the Lord. Nothing. Nothing is too hard for the Lord. The problem is that too many of us put God into our experience box. Well, I've never seen it, therefore I don't believe it ain't ever going to happen. Isn't that true? Come on, you all know it's true. You all do it. Every one of us, we all do it. I haven't experienced that. I've never seen that. I know it's in the Bible, but I don't believe it. Okay? But that's not the heart of God. Guys, we have got to get beyond this nonsense now. The world is yearning and aching to see a church that actually is relevant now. And the relevancy is not in the fact that you're a socially relevant gospel, but actually you're a countercultural people with the power of the living God dwelling not only in you, but on you. Hallelujah. And you need to believe it. Hallelujah. Do you know what? When I go around now, the Holy Spirit says, oh, can you, you know, every now and then, go up, go speak to that person, go pray for that person. I don't always do it, I must confess, but when I do, God always moves. The other day, we were just talking. Trace went out for a walk the other night, and some random lady running along the shoreline, I vaguely looked familiar, and she came up to us and said, oh, hi, you probably don't remember me. And I was like, And she looked familiar, that's about as best. She said, you might remember a few months back, you prayed for me here? I was like, oh yeah, vaguely remember. I said, so how did it go? She said, the very next day after you prayed, everything just changed. But that's because in that moment, when we were talking with her, a few months back, the Holy Spirit just said, pray for her. And I find that when you start doing what God tells you to do, you generally get the results that God wants you to get. Because it's not based on your fear. It's not even based on your faith. It's based on your obedience. And all you become then is just a channel of the living God. I mean, how easy can it be, right? God says, go do this. Okay, I'll go do it. Get the results. Hallelujah. Praise God. You just become a co-worker with the Spirit of God to see people's lives set free, to see people experience the power of God, and to see people experience deliverance in their life. That woman experienced the delivering power of the Almighty Living God. And people out there, they need to hear it. They need to know that there is a deliverer in this room right now. They need to know that all of you lot carry the power of the deliverer and the power of the healer and the power of the evangelist and the apostle and the prophet. You have everything in you that you need to life and godliness and to do all things through Christ Jesus, which strengthens you. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, glory, glory, glory. But it's our English reticence. You know what you can do with that English reticence? I'll let you think about it. And that's where it deserves to go, because we need this. We need to be cloaked in power, not English reticence. Yeah? We need to be a little bit crazy. Hallelujah. Because the reality is, if England win the cup today, right, you will see how crazy this nation will get. And it always concerns me that we have the potential to be absolutely mad, okay? With a pint of beer in us or not. Well, we have the potential to be absolutely mad, okay? The British were always known for their mad dog kind of attitude. And I want to see it in the church. I want to see it in you young guys. I want to see this madness for the kingdom of God. This like, look at my eyes. You see that wildness there? That's what you need to get in your eyes. That crazy world, he's going to do something. Look, okay, you need that in your eyes. Maybe not all the time. People will avoid you. But you need to have that conviction. I remember the old Scooby-Doo cartoons, and there was a little Scrappy-Doo. He's always, let me at him, let me at him. Yeah, that's the spirit that we need in Christians. Let me at him. There's a demon. Let me at him. Let me at him. Yeah? Where were we the other day? Tracy said to me, don't. Don't. There was some guy like, walking down the street. So, don't. There's a time and a place for everything. I was feeling it was the time and the place, but the wisdom of Lord's Tracy said no. Tracy was walking in a shop once, and this woman came up behind and going, not today, not today, not today, not today. And they're everywhere. They're out there. And people need to be redeemed and set free. Now, please don't misunderstand me. I appreciate there's people out there with a genuine mental illness. But guess what? In the old English, it says Jesus came to heal the lunatics. That means that's issues, that's people that were affected by the moon and stuff. But it literally means it's to do with mental illness as well. Jesus is here to heal people with mental illness. Jesus is here to heal people with physical illness. You see, Jesus, by his stripes, you are healed. When Jesus went to the cross, it wasn't just for your sins. It was for your guilt, your pain, your shame, your sicknesses, your sorrow. That Jesus didn't just become sin, but he became cancer. That Jesus became every sickness upon the earth. He became AIDS. He became mental illness. He became everything. Why? How? Here's the law. Here's how. Leviticus. You want that animal to atone for what you've done. You put your hands on it. You transferred what was ever on you onto that animal, so the animal takes the place for you. Lay your hands of sickness on the Lamb of God. Lay your hands of sickness on that Lamb of God, whether it's a sickness of your soul, a sickness of your mind, a sickness of your body. Lay hands on the Messiah and let him take it for you. There are people that are walking around with guilt, pain, and shame that you do not deserve to have, and you are not legally allowed to own, because Jesus took it all for you. I have to say this. It says in Proverbs 6 about how there are several things that are an abomination for the Lord. And here's one of the abominations that is an abomination to God. To convict an innocent man. To condemn an innocent man. And there are some Christians in here that you condemn yourself. Even though you've begged forgiveness for it, you still condemn yourself for it. I need you to know, and I don't mean to put this like this, but it has to be said, that you're an abomination. Oh no, I'm an abomination. Add that to my list of things that I'm really not good at. No, God wants you to understand how profane it is when you condemn yourself, when Jesus himself, God Almighty, has taken that sin from you. In other words, who do you think you are? You are not God, are you? You're not the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world, because that's what you're doing. You have no right to carry that guilt. You have no right to carry that shame, because Jesus loves you that much. He bore it for you. Accept that gift of love. Accept the power of his love. You know, it's love casteth out all fear. And Jesus wants you to know he loves you. And if he's forgiven you, then accept that forgiveness. Accept it. Hold on to it. And when your mind starts to condemn you, and when Mr. Devil comes in going, hey, remember that time when you did this, you do that, you just know. I take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ and say, sorry, Mr. Devil, that was dealt with a long time ago under the blood of Jesus. Now beat it. Get out. Hallelujah. God wants to pour out his spirit. Spirit within you is for you. The spirit on you is for everybody else. The Bible says, I think it's in one of the letters of John, that you are all anointed. You're all anointed. It's not for the special few, those chosen by God from the beginning of the foundation of the earth to do great and mighty deeds. You've all been anointed. And yes, there are some that have been chosen to do great and mighty deeds, but every one of us in this room can do great exploits for the Lord. Yeah? You can be a hero, heroine, in your day and age. I want to serve the purposes of God in my generation. Do you want to serve the purposes of God in your generation? Do you want to make a difference in this world? Do you want to like just do something where God can use you, where you can be a co-laborer with the Spirit of God and see him use you? Because like Jesus said, when the disciples came back at the woman of the well, they bought the garlic breads and everything, they're all coming back to Jesus and like, hey Jesus, we got the food. And he's like, I've eaten a food that you know not of. Where did you get that from? We've just been downtown, we're sweating, it's the heat of the day, we brought all this garlic bread back, and you've eaten. And he said, my food is doing the will of my Father. And let me tell you something now, there ain't nothing quite like it. There's nothing on earth more rewarding, more satisfying, more fulfilling than doing God's will. I used to do my dream job. My dream job was as a full-time musician. And I got to do all kinds of crazy stuff. I got to play with, did support for Electric Light Orchestra, for those young and old enough to remember them, okay? Those young enough, sort it out, okay? If you don't, you know who they. All right, Mr. Blue Sky, Electric Light Orchestra, okay? So I did support for these guys. I got to do some really cool stuff. I went to America, did all sorts of things. And it was a dream job. But you know what? Every time I used to do a performance with this band, and we there were times where it was, the crowd went absolutely wild. It was deafening what they were shouting and screaming and all this kind of stuff. And inside I just felt hollow, empty, cold. Even though I loved what I did, I used to come away feeling empty and cold. And I knew there and then, it's like, there's something better. Surely there is something better, because all that job did was give glory to man. Surely it's better to do something where you finally have something within you that gives glory to God. I'm reminded of a time that, just to explain the feeling, Claire used to run a group that used to go into this rest home. And there's this one particular guy who was constantly getting tremors and things and fits. And he came to know the Lord. And there was one time where we were trying to help him eat his dinner. Do you remember that? Okay. I'm kind of a selfish kind of guy, if I'm honest with you, okay? Those that know me know that. Those that don't, now you do. Okay, and he was really struggling to pick up this bit of broccoli. And I just put my fork on the broccoli and just put it into his mouth. And when he started eating it, I can't tell you the wave of emotion that came over me. It was like, that's what it feels like to do God's work. And it's not about just raising the dead and healing the sick. It's also about loving on people, loving the unlovable, being there for people, sharing the gospel, praying for people, just being a listening ear sometimes. It's not about doing power exploits, but it's also about being the kindness and the heart of Jesus to people as well. Amen? Hallelujah. So, let's all stand. Okay, there are people here that are actually not well in certain areas, mentally and physically and spiritually, the Holy Spirit's saying. I don't know what that looks like, but you know. So for those people, I want you to prepare yourselves in a minute to come forward and pray for you. But for all of us right now, I want us just to, as I pray this prayer, I want you to just really seek out and reach out for the living God, okay? Because you may call upon him while he is near, and he is here right now, and he is near right now. His presence is here among us. Oh Lord, my beautiful, blessed Holy Spirit, I love you, Lord. Lord, please, Holy Spirit, be here right now, Lord, we pray. Holy Spirit. Please be here, O God Almighty. Come here right now, Lord. My beautiful one, my lovely one, please come here right now. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is just telling me to do this. I'm just going to do it. And as I'm blowing, just receive by faith the Spirit of God upon you right now. Not just like the infilling of the Spirit, but a fresh infilling of his Spirit, that you may do exploits for the things of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. That some may prophesy, that some may speak in new tongues, that some may lay hands on the sick, that some may lay hands on the sick and they shall be healed, that others may share an encouraging word, that others may be Christ to the poor. And Lord, I thank you, Holy Spirit, that the power to heal is here right now. And so, brothers and sisters, we're going to pray as a body for those that come forward right now. I appreciate it's a bit scary to come forward, but for those that know that they need a touch of God for healing today, I want you to come forward right now, because this is no coincidence. God has deemed this service to be a healing service. So if you know that there's something wrong with you and you know that something's not right, I want you to come forward right now in Jesus' mighty name. Because God is a miracle God. I want you to look at this picture here. It's a picture of Jesus. And he's making a way where there is no way. That's impossible. Don't ever say to God, that's impossible. When Moses was like at the edge of this water, and God said to him, he was praying to God. God said, do something. Raise your staff. You have the power and authority of Christ in you and on you. You have a miracle delivering, powerful God living within you and upon you. There is nothing that is impossible for the Lord. There is nothing that is impossible for the Lord. He is mighty and his arm is strong and able, and he can make a way where there is no way, where the impossible lies before you, where things and circumstances and sicknesses and illnesses and diseases and sins that look unbreakable be broken in Jesus' name right now. Be broken right now in Jesus' name. You chains of bondage over these people, I break your power over them right now in Jesus' name. Now all the saints that are stood up, that aren't coming forward to pray, you just put your hands in the air and you just start agreeing with me in prayer right now. We're going to agree as a body to set the captives free, okay? We have Christ in us and we're going to agree as the body of Christ to set the captives free. Lord Jesus, Lord, we break the power of addiction, Lord Jesus, in the name of Jesus, by his power, by his authority, we break it right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Come on, saints. It's the prayer of an effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man that availeth much. Not English prayers, fervent prayers. And Lord, we pray, Lord God, for these people here. We break the spirit of addiction off these people right now in Jesus' name. We break it in Jesus' name. By his name, by his power, by his might. Hallelujah. We break that off these people in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Oh God, hallelujah. And those people that are afflicted with it's achy bones, like arthritis right now in Jesus' name, receive the healing power of the Lord. Receive the healing power, because the word of God is health to the bones in Jesus' name. Amen. I speak health to you sick bones in Jesus' name. I speak life to your sick bones right now in Jesus' name. Cartilage to recover, cartilage to grow in Jesus' mighty name. Lord God, those people with mental illness, Lord Jesus, that have been wrestling and struggling with things, in the name of Jesus, you will be free! In Jesus' name, be free! Have the mind of Christ, not the mind of your old self. Be free in Jesus' name, be free in Jesus' name, be free in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Lord, new strongholds in their minds to form, Lord God. New thought patterns, new synapses, Lord Jesus. That they would think with the mind of Christ and not with the mind of things that have been programmed into them from generation to generation. We break that in Jesus' name. And we speak life and wholeness and newness into these minds in Jesus' mighty name. Alzheimer's, in the name of Jesus, we bind you up and we cast you off right now in Jesus' name. We speak life over people's physical minds, Lord, right now in Jesus' name. We speak life over people's physical minds right now in Jesus' name. We command those brains, those physical minds, to work efficiently and effectively, and as they were fearfully and wonderfully designed to work. We will not have the robber or the destroyer or the locusts prying on people's minds, on their bodies, gnawing in their brains, gnawing on their joints, gnawing on their soul. We rebuke you, Satan, and you devils, in the name of Jesus, and we command you to leave these people, leave them alone, in Jesus' name, by his power, by his glory. Get out in Jesus' name and never return. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. The Lord wants you to know that what you're hearing now is the truth. It is the absolute truth. And the truth will set you
Amen.
Free.
Amen. Hallelujah. The truth will set us free. Now, everybody, let's hold our hands to the Lord. Hold them up high to the Lord. Every one of us, whether we admit it or not, we've got some stuff that we're all dealing with. Holy Spirit, I pray as our hands are held aloft, Lord, like a lightning rod, Lord Jesus, I just pray, Lord, that the lightning of God will just hit all of these people right now, Lord God, and the flashings of your Holy Spirit and the lightnings of your Spirit will flash through our soul, Lord God, and light us up, Lord God, and purge us and make us holy, and Lord, cleanse us and do a work within us, Lord Jesus, that will forever change us and forever transform us, that we will be a people that will live and die for the glory of God. And here's another thing, the Holy Holy Spirit saying, receive the spirit of joy. For the kingdom of heaven is righteousness, peace, and joy. Receive that spirit of joy right now. You need joy, joy, joy in your lamp. You need the joy of the Lord. Hallelujah. And Jesus says, receive my joy. Receive my joy. Receive my joy. Hallelujah. Let that joy break your depression. Let that joy break your sadness. Let that joy break the things that are troubling you and holding you down in the name of Jesus. Let the joy and the oil of the Lord fill you with gladness in Jesus' mighty name. For this is the joy of your salvation. Our God is a good God. He's a loving God. He's a kind God. And even in the midst of your most difficult circumstances and trials, the joy of the Lord is there. And your strength is your joy in the Lord. And the kingdom of heaven is righteousness, peace, and joy. And one more, shalom, peace. Receive his peace right now. Receive the peace of God right now. Oh, it's like an oil, and it just purifies us and cleanses. I can see it now running into people's very tendrils of their mind, bringing peace where there is torment to their mind. It's going right through into your physical body and bringing peace where there is aches and pains. I see it going right into the very essence of your soul and bringing peace where there is angst. Oh, let the oil of the living God flow through you. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Oh, Lord Jesus, we thank you for today, Lord. We thank you that you're so good to us. We thank you, you're so kind to us, and you're so loving. We love you, blessed Holy Spirit. We love you, Father. We love you, Son. We thank you that there is only one true God, and you are him. Hallelujah. And all the saints said, amen. Hallelujah.